Abortion rights taking center stage once again in the health care reform debate. Nebraska Senator Ben Nelson saying he plans to introduce an anti-abortion amendment mirrored in the STUPAC amendment that was approved in the House. That measure prohibits the use of federal funds to cover abortions for women in the public option, and goes beyond that to say that private insurance plans sold on a publicly funded national insurance exchange could also not offer elective abortion coverage unless they offered an identical plan without it. The question is, do young women, the ones most affected by this legislation, really care? For the first time since the question was asked in 1995, a majority of Americans identified themselves as pro-life when it comes to abortion rights. Are we looking at a generational rift, or at least a generational shift, on the abortion issue? Katie Walker, Communications Director for the American Life League. We're also joined by Chrystia Freeland, U.S. Managing Editor for the Financial Times. Katie, you brought up this data the last time that you were here. What is the demographic that you are seeing in terms of at least the polling shift and how people respond to pro-life versus pro-choice?
Well, Dylan, you brought up a great question earlier. You said, do young women care? And I think the answer is yes. But the difference is, today's young women care about true justice. And we're beginning to understand that that has to start in the womb. We're very well aware that 1 in 4 of my generation has been aborted. Our rights have been assaulted from the moment we were, from our very biological beginning. Yeah. So any kind of discussion on women's rights or human rights has to start with personhood at the biological beginning of development.
And clearly, for America, there is no more compelling conversation than this one, and again, no more difficult political conversation than this one. I'm curious, Katie, what your view is as to the injection of an effort to alter the government's regulation and set of laws relative to abortion into the overall healthcare debate. In other words, should we be having a separate debate, one that you make very appropriate points about how and what the political views on abortion are in America, and are we doing a disservice to the healthcare debate and the abortion debate to try to use the abortion debate or to inject the abortion debate into the healthcare debate?
The healthcare debate from the very beginning has been about human rights. Any kind of discussion on healthcare, as I said a few days ago, has to be rooted in the dignity of the human person. That means the personhood of every human being has to be protected. And that's the message of the pro-life movement.
And I agree. Katie, yeah, go ahead.
Can I ask you a question, Katie? Are you in favor of a blanket ban on abortion in all circumstances? For example, even in cases of rape or where the health of the mother is in jeopardy?
I'm in favor of recognizing the personhood of every human being from their biological beginning.
And does that mean abortion would be illegal in all circumstances? Is that what you would like if you were writing the law right now?
If I were writing the law, every human being would be protected.
So
yes.
If a 15-year-old girl is raped, she can't get an abortion.
Why are we going to punish the child
Just a yes or no, Katie. No abortion in any circumstances?
No abortion in any circumstances. And I think that's an opinion that is more and more recognized by the American people.
If you got that kind of a law passed, do you think that we would see the same political passivity among younger women? Or do you think that there would be, from your political point of view, a danger of a backlash and that women would say, you know what, it's one thing to have my views on a survey, but if I'm in trouble and there's nothing I can do, I have to go across the border to Canada or Mexico, we might see more activism. Is that something that you've thought about?
Well, I think the question behind what you're asking is something that you need to think about as well. I mean, it's a very simple, the core kernel of what you're asking me. Do all human beings deserve human rights, yes or no?
No, I disagree with that. That's not the question, because you're assuming that everybody has agreed, which I know is not the case in this country, that personhood begins at the moment of conception. And for you, that is true. But I can tell you, I can put other human beings that are Americans who pay taxes who disagree with you, who think that personhood begins at birth. So your assumption that human beings...
I don't know the last time you checked with the embryology textbooks, but I think the scientific community is very much in agreement that a human being's life begins at the very biological beginning.
So a human being is 2 cells on the street?
Yes.
And that's a conversation I honestly want to have? I cannot wait to have that conversation because I don't know the answer, quite honestly. You clearly do. I'd like to have the debate with you. We don't have the time to do it right now, but Katie, I do hope you come back to continue this conversation. Chrystia, thank you for joining us,
pleasure,
albeit briefly. The takeaway here right after this.